Hello and welcome to Insight here on Zodiak. My name is Teresa Ndanga, your usual host of the program. Today we're discussing the report by the Parliamentary Committee which was investigating the Zambia maize deal. The report was read and presented in Parliament, and my guest today is the chairperson of the committee, Honorable Dr. Joseph Chidanti Malunga. Doctor, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Teresa.
Well, you have presented the report after a three-week investigation,
right.
Inquiry, having people come to you to tell their side of the story into this issue.
Yes.
What would you say are the three major findings?
Right. Thank you very much. First of all, let me thank you for having me in the program. And I believe that it's a way of disseminating some of the issues that are in the report. And what I read out yesterday, just the insights. It was just a speech made of some of the things that we have picked from the report. Because the report is too big, we could not. I could not read it out the whole of it. But the major findings, as you know, is that first of all, there were procurement procedures that were flouted, and secondly, we found out that powers were abused. Especially at the ministerial level by the Minister of Agriculture. He actually abused his powers to impose certain decisions that were not supposed to be done that way. And therefore, he concluded that probably there could be acts of or elements of corruption in the process. So there are several recommendations specifically for each and every stakeholder that we interviewed. I guess we'll come to that later in the program, but I think those are the major issues that we found out: flouting of procedures and abuse of power, and therefore probably traces of or elements of corruption in the process.
Okay. Let's begin by looking at ADMAC, where you're saying procedures were flouted. First of all, when we're talking about procurement procedures, obviously the Office of the Director of Public Procurement comes in.
Yeah.
Do you think that they also played their role properly to expectation?
Well, first of all, remember that there's a huge sum amount of money involved, $34.5 million. It's a lot of money.
Right.
And that has to be done in a manner that the people would be confident of the officers that are carrying out this particular procurement. And therefore, they had to seek permission from Office of Director of Public Procurement, giving no objection to say, go ahead and procure this. We agree with you and all that. But we found out that the even the Office of OTPP was very casual in the way they handled this, because some of the instructions were issued on the phone and basically on a Saturday without necessarily going through or critically looking at what is it that ADMAC was asking from them. But ADMAC did ask them, can we go ahead and do this, right? But them, they were very casual and say, okay, go ahead and although later we found out that the time they were doing that, they had already gone into contract with the suppliers. So maybe it was just trying to formalize the process. But the investigation revealed that that was not the case, that that they were not asking in good faith. They were just basically trying to formalize the process. So the even them or DPP also did not follow the laid down procedures under their own regulations. You know, they could just, okay, go ahead. And then later on we found out that when they had asked for one no go ahead, later on ADMAC asked for another without necessarily asking what is it they're asking. They keep saying, okay, go ahead, go ahead. So we thought that that was very casual on the part of OTPP.
Right. Why would you think? Why do you think that ADMAC would go ahead to start the process, even before getting a no objection from ODPP? Why were they in so much a hurry? Even the office of the Director of Public Procurement, even the other officers, it seems like everyone was in a hurry.
Mm. Well, from the testimonies, everyone that came, most of the stakeholders, ADMAG, Minister of Agriculture, ODPP themselves, they say they were under pressure. And although they didn't say where the pressure was coming from, but look, if you look at the setup, the hierarchy of the ministry, the Minister of Agriculture, for example, ADMAG, there's no the only pressure that can be exerted on them is from above, and that is from the ministry. And now from the ministry, the PS also said she was under pressure. It means someone else above the PS. So that's why we are saying probably the pressure was coming from the minister himself.
Mm-hmm.
So it was pressure really exerted on them that can we rush? But there are questions around that, that why do we have to rush? Because you remember that the maize that they were buying was not the maize that we needed for humanitarian assistance. It was the maize that we needed for commercial purposes, the maize that we wanted to sell, the maize that you and me would go to an ADMAG and buy. So did we really have to do that in a hasty manner like that? Those are the questions that you and me should ask.
So when the CEO of ADMAG appeared before your committee, he didn't mention at all the Minister of Agriculture, whom your committee suspects was exerting pressure on ADMAG and other officials. Mm. Why would you want to conclude that it was the Agriculture Minister?
Well, I'm looking at where do they report to? They report to the minister itself, and the highest political office is the one that the Minister of Agriculture was holding, and therefore it must be the Minister of Agriculture who was exerting pressure on this.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we're saying it was the minister himself exerting pressure.
So yeah. After the investigation, and the minister himself did appear before your committee,
right.
From your findings, to what extent was the minister involved in the whole process?
The minister was involved big time. When he appeared, this is his own testimony. He said suppliers or people kept coming to him when it was found out that there was need to supply maize to ADMAG. People came to him to say, can we supply maize? Can we do ABCD? Can we do that? He said it, that people were coming to him. Now, this is very unusual. How would someone, if I want to supply something, why would I go to the minister instead of going to the technocrats in that ministry? So that's why we're saying that he played a big role in deciding who should supply, right? And he actually said, at one moment, Transgroup came to him and said, we want to supply maize. And he said, okay, because this maize is coming from Zambia, can you go to Zambia? That's what the minister said himself. So that's why we're saying that he was actually the one authorizing who should supply maize. And remember, the name of Transgroup, we never knew about it the first 2 weeks that we did the investigation in Malawi. We only found out when we went to Zambia. And in fact, the permanent secretary of the Ministry of Agriculture in Zambia just reviewed this to us unknowingly, that there was this other player, that the 10,000 metric tons was supposed to be shipped from Zambia to Malawi, 50% of that had actually been given to Transglobe.
Now which is quite a tonnage.
Big time. So we checked through the documents. There was nowhere Transglobe had a contract with anyone.
And do you think that all these officials, the Minister of Agriculture, the Principal Secretary, the Reserve Bank, the Minister of Agriculture himself, ADMAG, so do you think all these people who appeared before your committee in the first 2 weeks knew about Transglobe?
I don't know about the Principal Secretary, and definitely I know that the minister knew. But if you look at the testimony that the PS gave us, she said that as a minister, their main role was basically to facilitate where to get maize, and that's it. And who should supply whatsoever was left with the ADMAG. Now you have a minister who comes in and says, actually I was the one who was actually saying, okay, this one should supply. Then you have a feeling that probably maybe the minister was bypassed. The minister probably didn't know, because that's what that's the feeling that you have, or from if you take the two testimonies.
Wouldn't the officials maybe ADMAG or the principal secretary, wouldn't it also be that maybe they're just protecting?
No, ADMAG, I believe they knew. ADMAG, I believe they knew, because you remember, for whoever was going to supply, they had to be paid, right? And the payment, there were some documents that had to originate from ADMAG. So there's no way one would supply and be paid without ADMAG knowing, because they were going to originate the documents for payment. And therefore, whoever was going to supply, was ADMAG was going to be in full knowledge of who it was going to be. So I believe that ADMAG was aware, but probably, maybe the ministry was bypassed, the whole ministry, except the top of the ministry, in which case the minister himself, because the people just went in. Like I said, that Transglobe did not appear anywhere until we were told by the Permanent Secretary of the Agriculture Minister in Zambia, who said, actually, 50% was supposed to be shipped by Transglobe. It was a shock to us. Where did Transglobe come from? Right.
So you talk about elements of corruption appearing in this whole equation. Mm-hmm. When you're talking about elements of corruption, which parties are you suspecting of corruption in this case?
Well, we are suspecting that if I take you back a little bit in the whole process, in the report we say that the whole deal was actually initiated by one Grace Muhangu. Grace Muhangu is the who played all this, to say, I have found this.
Of the Grain Trade Association?
Grain Trade Association of Malawi. She went to Zambia, and by the way, she's just some private business person somewhere. But she went to Zambia and talked to the suppliers in Zambia, and then talked to the ADMAG over here, invited ADMAG to go to Zambia, and played all the other roles that you know, that has led to all this. It was actually her, according to the testimonies that we heard. And
did you get that same sense when she appeared, because she came?
Yes, we did that. We did get that, although it was jumpy, flip-flopping as usual. But I mean, at the end of the day, you have to make your own story out of it, which we did, to say, I think it was her who played all this. That's why we're recommending that SB should actually investigate her. But otherwise, it was her, basically, who played all this. Now, the feeling that we have is that when this was done by her, Todd and Mike and all this, and then it was probably the minister in the equation now, and then introducing Transglobe to be part of the suppliers of the 100,000 metric tons. 50,000 metric tons is a lot of maize, and a lot of money involved, probably $18 million thereabout. So we believe that the corruption thing is basically, SB is going to investigate this, but I think the corruption is going to center around ADMAG, Mijiga, and then the minister. That's okay. Where we think the corruption.
And Transglobe doesn't come into.
And Transglobe, exactly. Thank
right.
you. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk about when the minister came and appeared before you. He repeatedly said that the house was on fire. Mm-hmm. He kept reminding the committee that when you are making your determinations, you should remember that the house was on fire. Do you think, from that statement, do you think the minister himself was also under pressure?
Well, what he meant was that the procedures were flouted, broken, because they had to do this because there was a sense of urgency in the country. There was hunger looming. But we are saying the maize that we are buying is not going to be given to the poor Malawian out there who cannot afford a 50 kg bag. Mm-hmm. It was going to be stuck in the ADMAG tables for people to buy. So the people that buy, there's no sense of urgency whatsoever. So what he was saying was not correct. And I know that this came from the figures that they got from MVAC to say 6.5 million people would go hungry, and therefore we have to buy this. But that was done by, the response to that was done by the donors. The donors, you know, give us a lot of food, World Food Program, for example, the Chinese government, and several other donors actually responded to that. and give us a lot of maize. NRFA was given money, even ADMAC was also given money to buy locally, so that it actually cushions out whatever they were talking about. But then later it transpired that what they were saying was not as grave as they were trying to put it.
Yeah, so you think MVAG actually misled the nation, misled the officials?
Big time. MVAG is is at the center, or the one that created all this mess, because they are the ones that provided the figures. Before this, you should remember that before this inquiry, we actually had condemned them in our committee, in the agriculture committee. We condemned them. We say, MVAG, we don't want them. First of all, why are they sitting in the Minister of Finance? If they are projecting numbers to do with the hunger, then they should sit in the Minister of Agriculture. Why are they sitting in the Minister of Finance? So that gives you questions, really, to say, what is it that they are doing there? Are they competent enough to do what they are doing? Now, number one, before what we're talking about, they had projected that the 2.8 million people would go hungry at Mwano. I think that was in 2014, 15, right. Thereabout. Right. And then it transpired that the whole country went hungry, which meant their numbers were not correct. Now, the following year, they overestimate 6.5 million. Yes, people are going to be hungry, but that's the number was over-exaggerated. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it is MVAG actually who created all this mess.
Well, do you think that it is just out of incompetence on the part of MVAG, or would you think that it was actually a plan to get into the mess that we're in today?
Those are the questions that we should be asking, to say, is it incompetence? Incompetence, I would say yes, because I don't believe they have the capacity to do this. To go out and really estimate the people that could go hungry is not a small job. We sit in the constituencies, we see them coming under a tree and sitting in the rest houses, and 2-3 days they're off, and they say, okay, now we know how many people are going to be hungry in Isanje. Is that correct? The answer is no. So those guys are totally incompetent. They don't know what they're doing. Secondly, because of the incompetence, they were now used to actually create these numbers that we are talking about. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So both your committee and the state commissioned inquiry that was led by Justice Anastasia Msosa seem to agree that there should be an investigation. ACB should investigate the Minister of Agriculture, Dr. George Chabonda, and other players that you mentioned earlier on. Mm. But specifically to the Honorable Minister, Dr. George Chabonda, what do you think should have happened by now, after the State Commissioned Inquiry presented a report to the President, and now after you have presented your report as well in Parliament? What do you think should happen immediately?
We have recommended that the State President should publicly censure the Honorable Minister and tell the nation that probably this is what happened, and we are surprised that that is not happening up to now, apart from ACB investigating and all that. But we believe that it should have been relieved of its duties, and so that it creates a trust in the people. But that is not happening. Well, I don't know. But personally, I believe that that should have happened by now. Mm-hmm. That it should have been, relieved of his duties.
And why specifically would you want the minister to be removed from the ministerial position at the moment? Because he has he has repeatedly said, in his defense, he has said that, at the moment I'm innocent until I'm proven guilty.
Exactly. We know that. He's innocent until proven guilty. But he's at the center of this. He's the head, or he was the head in the ministry. This ministry we're talking about is the Ministry of Agriculture, which he was heading. So we are in this mess because of him. And therefore, he must step aside, so that investigations can go smoothly. SB is going to go in. SB is going to investigate while he's sitting in the office. That is very abnormal.
And while we're talking about this, your recommendations came in, and just a few days later, his office was gutted by fire. Mm. Does that worry you?
Oh yeah. I mean, it raises a lot of suspicion, and because the that I think that was before actually we presented our report. We presented our report a day later, but I think the inquiry, the presidential inquiry, had already done that report that it must be investigated by ACB. And then you have an office where the documents are kept going on fire. What is that telling to the nation? So we believe that something fishy is going on, and maybe the extension to the inquiry should also go into what caused the fire, what was the reason why fire was the fire guarded his office. So there are a lot of suspicions around that. I mean, you and me would just guess there, and I know that people watching us are also guessing. But your guess is also my guess, to say maybe something fishy is going on.
But would you still be confident if the ACB investigated Dr. Chabonda in the situation we're in, where his office was gutted, probably some documents, important documents there, were also destroyed? Would you still be confident in an investigation by the ACB right now?
Well, we want to wait and see what ACB can come up with. There's a huge amount of evidence out there, including ourselves. What we put in the report is just a part of it. We have evidence in audio, evidence in video, and let's not speculate until we reach the end and see what ACB is going to do. At this moment, let's think that they're going to do a good job, and I believe they're going to do a good job, and let's not condemn them before we actually get there, because there's a lot of evidence, some of it coming through unknown sources and all that. And I think the other time I was listening to the director of OSTB had said that they have received tremendous amount of evidence pointing to the same. So I believe that with all that information, they should be able to come up with a good job.
Right. So just clear the air for us. Mm. Your findings do not point to any exchange of money between any of the parties, but you still think that there are elements of corruption, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Well, if the intention, if there was intention to do that, it is still an element of corruption. Yeah, the intention was there. So you have to understand that this was discovered at the moment when no payment was made. But we discovered receipts, or invoices rather, that were asking for payment, and the invoice was not paid. So because of that, that's why we're saying that the some elements of corruption could have happened. But I would like to agree with you that we don't believe that money has exchanged hands yet, but it was going to exchange hands. And in that case, that's why we say that elements of corruption indeed may have occurred.
And how do you think the country should deal with an intent to bribe someone, or where corruption has not actually taken place yet, but you are convinced that there was that intent? What do you think the country should be doing in such situations, which is probably the case in this case?
Yeah, so I think it is up to ACB to, but we think that there should be some kind of punishment to the officers that are involved in doing this. Of course, no money exchange has, but if there was intent, I'm sure the law does provide for that, and you know where the intent was. So I'm sure the people with legal minds should be able to interpret that and see what could be done to officers that do that. But I can assure you that there was intention to do corrupt practices.
And one final topic that I want us to quickly discuss is one recommendation, one of the issues that you don't seem to be amused with, and that was that some officials, senior officials, government officials, came before your committee and lied, you say.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate?
Yes. We believe that when someone is summoned before a parliamentary committee, you have to say the truth. And in fact, when you are taken through the oath, it says there's nothing else that I'm going to do apart from saying the truth, and therefore, God, can you please help me? But we have the Secretary to the Treasury, Dr. Mangani, we have the Reserve Bank Governor, Mr. Chuga, who actually said, we don't know anything, we never knew about Kalose until we read it in the papers. That's what they said. But when ADMAC reappeared, they showed us some emails to say there was some email communication between the office of the Minister of Finance, rather, I think from the director of DATE, Ms. Nyambose, Madalo Nyambose, actually responding to some conversation that was going on between the three of these guys. So we said, oh, wow, I mean, these guys can say they never knew when they were actually exchanging emails. So to us, it meant that they lied, and therefore they must be taken to task for lying.
Yeah. What's the recommendation? What's the action that you think should happen?
It is up to Director of Public Prosecution. We have asked Director of Public Prosecution to take action on these officers that lied. So again, they look at the law and see what is the relevant law that is recommended for the people that lie under oath.
Right. Yeah. Honorable, finally, all work is done. You've presented this report. What's mm-hmm. next?
The next thing is that it has to be debated in Parliament, and then after debate, it has to be adopted by Parliament. After adoption, then it becomes a legal document. As we are talking, it is just a report. We are waiting for Parliament to give us time. And as you know, that as a committee, we don't decide the business of the House. We don't. We just give them, and then it is up to the business committee of the House, headed by the Speaker, and in conjunction with the leader of the House, who will decide when it can be debated. After it has been debated, then it has to be adopted. When you adopt it, it becomes a legal document. So all those recommendations that we put in there will now come into effect after it has been adopted by Parliament, because now it becomes a reference document, mm-hmm. not as we're talking. As we're talking, it's just a report. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Honorable Malunga, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Teresa.
It was a pleasure having you here.
Thank you.
To elaborate on this.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Sure.